I am a recording artist, a radio personality, an actress, a TEDx speaker, and most recently, a certified master life coach. And I am just like you, on this wild ride, a page-turning book filled with victorious chapters and chapters of sheer defeat. Well, I'm here in the arena now, here to help you create a beautiful life.
Does it look good?
Does what look, look good?
You don't notice my hair?
You look like Snooki meets a freestyle singer. I don't know. What is that?
Well, there's a reason why I'm wearing this. But let me do the intro first.
Okay? I think you should. Go ahead.
Okay. Hola mi gente, this is your favorite chica, Judy Torres. Welcome to Beautiful Life with Judy Torres, the podcast. Every other week, we try to post an episode here. And for the first time this season, we are doing it via YouTube. So you can also see what I look like right now. But if you're new to the podcast, welcome to the podcast. And just let me tell you a little bit about myself. I am a recording artist for over 35 years, a radio personality for 22 years, a life coach for over 3, a TEDx speaker, an actress recently on Blue Bloods, and more and more and more. And basically the whole intention of the podcast is to inspire, encourage, and empower people from all over the place, no matter what they're doing. And so I thought that the last two episodes, as good as they were pretty depressing. So it's time for us to have some fun. Right, Vinny?
Absolutely. So, but the headphones this way, what's going on right
well,
now?
I'm holding them like this because I can't get the headphones on with this clip, but I have this clip on because if you follow her on social media, I'm talking about, she's got over 154,000 followers on Facebook, over 200,000 followers on Instagram, and over 5.5 million likes on TikTok. I am talking about Staten Island's own sweetheart, One Funny Lisa Marie, Lisa Marie Riley.
Before we bring her in, I have to tell you, Judy, you know, I'm with the rest of the world tonight. We're mourning. We're mourning hard.
What are we mourning?
The loss of Mimi Martinez.
Oh, Mimi Martinez, you know, she's so near and dear to my heart.
I want you to know something. I canceled my plans on a week off from work because I'm a teacher during the day. I canceled my Friday night plans. I was so excited. Judy Torres is coming out on Blue Bloods. I got my parents watching. We go, we're gathered in the living room. We sit down. Boom. Mimi Martinez comes out. Awesome. This is going to be great. And then all of a sudden we turn and she's dead on the floor.
That's it. It's over.
What happened?
You know, well, this was my first TV role ever. And it was so exciting that it was on CBS Blue Bloods, you know, over 6 million people watch it live every week. And this was the first, their first episode back after the Super Bowl. And so I was really excited. I got cast as Mimi Martinez and I'm like, yes, this is great. She plays a celebrity TV chef with her own talk show, The Mimi Show. And I was like, yes, everything that I would want in real life was there.
I mean, talk about manifesting it. You really did.
Yeah, for real.
You played yourself.
No, not really, because I did have the intention in my head, who is Mimi Martinez? What has she done? How old is she? You know, you make up the character in your head. And so she's more, you know, sure of herself. She's more like, I don't know, bubbly, a little more bubbly. But maybe, who knows, maybe it was sort of me. I mean, I kind of knew when I did the audition, I was like, I think I have a shot at this for real, because she says hola everyone. And I would say hola mi gente. So I'm like, I could do hola everyone. I could do that, you know, and it was just really exciting. It's just hysterical that those two scenes that they put together as one scene. So I was on there for like a minute, took like hours, literally. So not because I got the lines wrong or anything, just because they film with different points of view, different camera work and things like that. But it was a great, great experience. And shout out to the entire cast and crew of Blue Bloods on CBS. They were incredible. They were just, I mean, talk about feeling special. They were amazing. And they didn't know who I was. Everyone was treated special. That's what I loved about them all. Everyone was treated like a star.
Let's bring in this week's guest. I'm very excited. You know, when you just wind up getting to work with somebody for the first time and you know there's something special about them. Mm-hmm. I had that encounter when I got to bring her on stage at a big venue here in Staten Island called the St. George Theater. I got to connect with her. We've worked together this one night and I knew that she is somebody who's a force to be reckoned with. In a very dark world with what we've experienced, mm-hmm. there are certain people that carry the light. And I believe this young lady is a torch carrier. And I believe that she lets the light shine from within and brings happiness to so many people. And she's overcoming some things of her own. I'm sure you guys will talk about that, but I'm really happy to connect two amazing forces in Judy Torres. And of course, One Funny Lisa Marie Riley. Welcome aboard.
Hey,
Lisa, how are you? How do you think I look?
Good for us. You look fantastic. Good for us.
Do you like my clip? Am I sporting it? Like, is it high enough? But I think this is a good sign of motherhood.
But I've had this since the seventh grade. So this didn't change. You could see all my pictures as a kid. I always had my hand.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time out to be on the podcast with me, because I know that you're one busy woman.
I'm flattered that you asked. Tremendous fan. Adored you always. And I think it's wonderful. Thank you for asking me to be on. I appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. And you said we met before, right?
Yeah, I was at C2. I finally got to go out one night, me and my sister.
Please, by all means, let people know, like, how did you start with social media? What gave you the idea? What was the intention when you first started doing that?
I was in a group text message with my cousins and my sister all the time. And I got very annoyed in the group message because it was always going and the lols and all that stuff.
The LOLs.
And it annoyed me. So my sister goes, why don't you do an Instagram page and we could talk to you like that? And I said, okay, you know, whatever. So what happened was, why it started was because, unfortunately, my husband got diagnosed with cancer. When he got diagnosed with cancer in 2019, we didn't know what to do. So as he was going through that, it became something to do to get my mind off of the reality. So it was first day of chemo. Sister sent me the page and she was just do whatever. So we had the face things that may change the face and we laughed and we joke around and it became a beautiful distraction from reality. And here we are, 3.5 years later, still doing it. And it's becoming a distraction. Yeah. Yeah.
And 2019, if I recall correctly, that's also the time that COVID really hit us hard.
It became a lifesaver because mentally it just did a lot for me. And it was a lifesaver. I mean, I would never do this. Like, only go on social media. And I didn't think anything was going to happen. You know, you make friends and whatever, but what a group of friends I made. All the people, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, just a wonderful group of friends.
That's amazing. Great. Yeah. Would you say that the fans on TikTok are different than the fans on Instagram and Facebook? Judy, and if so, how?
I'm laughing, yeah. Judy. You still got the hair clipping.
I'm just trying to relate. You know, I feel like if I put the hair clip on, suddenly I can feel Lisa. Yeah. Okay, now I feel like I look ridiculous.
You look fantastic.
So getting back to the question, do you think the fans are different?
Yeah, like TikTok's more like you do the things. I mean, I don't really do them, but they got the dancing and all that. Instagram, they're different. And Facebook, you know, they're just, everybody's different.
I was looking at your Instagram page, right? And I enjoyed watching from the beginning when you first started. You would have like 1900 views, and from that to like hundreds of thousands and all these million likes and stuff like that. So what was that feeling? When did it first click for you? Like, ooh, something's going on here that I had no idea was going to happen.
When people started asking me to do things, I'm like, what do they want me to do? Why do they want me to do that? And we laughed about it.
What were they asking you to do?
Like Access Hollywood and CNN and all that. I go, get out of here. Are they serious? They want me. I said, come on, what are you going to do with me? And then I said, all right. I said, wow. I said, you know, it's crazy. It's crazy. Like, you know, it's unbelievable how the world transitions. You know what I mean? I think back when I was younger, this was around, you know what I mean? And now it's here and everybody goes on it. That's the new thing. And it's amazing that I've got such a positive feedback from it. And it helped me in such a time where I didn't think that nothing would help me. I did. You know, you get like that, but you have friends on there that they check in on you and they talk to you and everybody's got their own gotses and their own things going on. And it's become a wonderful place to go.
I think one of the reasons why people love you so much is because when we listen to you, we can relate. You know, for example, one of my favorite ones that you did was the one about Victoria's Secret. You're like, I have a secret. Nothing fits.
She's got a whole other thing going on, Victoria. And I feel terrible. I known her my whole life, but I was never able to participate in her functions. You know what I mean? She sends me the thing in a while, come to my sale. What am I going to do at your sale?
Are we ever going to wear wings ever?
God knew what he was doing when he made me. He made sure if I wasn't, he made me exactly how I should be. Because if I looked like a Giselle, I'm wearing it 24/7. I'll be trusted.
You'd be walking down Target with the wings going like this. Another one of my favorite ones is the what about the help wanted sign. Because the help wanted sign just said help wanted. It didn't say what it needed help with.
Because they know I become the job. I don't even want to know the requirements, because if I need to work, I'm going to become the job. So whatever they needed me for, I can help. I can help.
I loved it. I love that one. I also loved, around fall, that's when we talk about pumpkin everything. You said no more pumpkin pushing. You were upset because it was August and they were already talking about the pumpkin.
You can't go nowhere without that pumpkin. It's all over. I don't even like the pumpkin. I don't want it. You want a pumpkin push? Want a pumpkin, a pump. I said, I want nothing with the pumpkin. I want nothing with it.
I don't even really like things with pumpkin, but ironically, I like the pumpkin spice latte, which is interesting.
All right. You know, a lot of people do. It's very popular. People go, I can't wait for it to come. I could care less. I'm just not the type. I like coffee. I like regular coffee. And that's it. It serves one function, waking me up.
Wow. So what was the feeling like when you did your first show? Was that something you always wanted to do? Did you ever think that you'd be doing that?
No,
so,
I didn't.
So walk me through, because like I had a one-woman show a few years ago, and I remember the first day, right before the curtain was going to go up for me to come on stage, and I remember thinking, what the hell was I thinking? Oh my God, what am I doing? So walk me through that. Like, what were you feeling before you went on stage?
You're going to get paid.
Oh, girl. Oh, I love you.
So I said, all right.
That's not what I was thinking, but I'm glad you were thinking.
That's what I was thinking. I said, I'm paid to do this. All right, I'm going to do it. I become the job. I have no qualifications. I've never done this before. I'm not a comedian. I don't call myself a comedian because I wouldn't take that from people that practice to do that. That's their job. They're weathered in it. They know what they're doing. I go on there. I just talk. They go, do you prepare a set? I don't even know what a set is. I just go up and I talk. And it's wonderful because we laugh, have a nice time. Yeah.
There are some celebrities who follow you. Has any celebrity that followed you, did you like flip out when you found out? You're like, oh my God, so-and-so is following me.
All of them. Even, you know what though? I have to be fair. Anytime somebody follows me, celebrity, non-celebrity, it's like a crazy thing that somebody would be interested in you. Like, what are you interested in me for? You know what I mean? Like, it's amazing. And the celebrities that follow, I'm like, oh my God, could you believe it? Like, I watch these people on TV. Now they talk to me. But even the people that aren't celebrities, I really appreciate them because you're going out of your way to want to know me. And I think that that's just so unbelievable. I really do. I really think it's just amazing. You know, I wouldn't want to follow me. What am I going to do with me? You know what I mean?
Well, you're with yourself for the rest of your life, Lisa Marie.
I'm stuck with myself. I'm a whole other problem. I got to stay with myself for the whole life. I fight with myself sometimes. I don't know how I still talk to myself. You know what I mean? And and it's amazing.
I wonder what it's like to live in your head.
My brain goes a mile a minute. I'm thinking of the next 2 weeks. I have a planner. I write everything down. I don't do this new age. Put it in your phone. I wouldn't even know how to find it. I log everything on pen and paper. I like the old ways. I like them. I appreciate them. It's not broke, don't fix it. I mean, you adapt to the whole social media that's new, but I'm old school. I do the pen and paper. I do all that stuff. I'm just still, you know, waking up at 4:30. I got a percolator. I'm not adjusting to anything new. You know what I mean? Yeah. Right. So I just, it's a new world. It's a new, wonderful world. You know what I mean?
So social. If you're old school, are you the type of person that does the to-do list every day?
Stop with this. I got the whole book. Somebody got the book. I got my whole life planned out right here. What we're going to do.
I love it.
I even write down, listen to me. I write down my songs that I want to, that I like. I like to read it and cross it off. I feel like I accomplished something. You know what
I mean? You know, that's a big deal. That's a really big deal for all of us. And the funny thing is, sometimes you make a to-do list and your to-do list has nothing to do with the things you actually want to get done. It just gives us something, this feeling that we did do things. So what are the top three things on your to-do list for tomorrow, let's say?
Well, I make my dinner every morning. Every single morning, my dinner is made before six. It's got to be done. Mm-hmm. 6:30 is late. I mean, I have no life. So that's what I do in the morning. I don't have a life. I'm not this big.
You've got a big life. Yes. I can't even, I just really, imagine.
I'm a creature of habit. You know what I mean? I have a thing that I got to do, and I'll write, like, don't forget to, you know, put the cup in the cabinet. Like I just log everything down. So I feel like I got all this stuff to do and I got to accomplish it because it's one thing I have control over in the chaos of everything. Control over going to the dollar store. I got control over vacuuming. I got control over cleaning the toilet bowl. You know what? I got control over that.
What is one of the household chores that you do not like to do and why?
Putting the laundry away. I dread it because you know what's going to happen in that drawer? You know what's going to happen in that drawer when you put the clothes? It'll look like it goes like that party in the drawer. Party in the drawer. Why fold it? You fold it so it fits, but by the time you pull out that drawer, it looks like it was a scabilla, right?
What about folding a fitted sheet? Do you have that mastered?
Listen to me. You're not going to believe me. Every pair of sheets I have are on the beds. Because
They're on the bed?
I swear to God, I have four sets of sheets on my bed, so I just pull off the top one, and I got the next one already waiting. So I don't have to worry about doing it.
Oh my God, I love that. Thank you for making me laugh. Oh my God.
But it's the truth. Think about it. You put four sets of sheets on your bed, you're good.
And it provides extra cushioning, right?
No, it just gets it done. Because if you're a nut like myself, I don't want to keep laying across that bed. Like I'm, you know, Rose from the Titanic, throwing myself across the bed of the job and it's done. And then you just wash the top one and you put it back on.
I should try that. That's a good idea. We'll call it the Lisa Marie way.
Yes, so you got the form.
Just layer it.
See, and you read that Kondo woman's book. You could have saved all that time reading that book.
Did you read the Marie Kondo book?
I don't read.
she has a whole procedure of how you can declutter your home and make it nice and airy so that the space is peaceful and you're happy. You're not happy.
I walk across Legos. I almost cripple myself walking across Legos on the floor. My son's got the knife, stepping slime. You know, you got the whole thing there. I don't, if she wants to come here, my door's open, but I think she's going to walk anyway.
So now you have three children, right?
I have two stepdaughters and my son, yes.
Okay. I'm one of five children. Wow. And so what I do is I tease my brothers and sisters all the time. When I sign anything to my mom, I always write, love your favorite daughter, your favorite child, love your number one, you know, stuff like that. And it's gotten us in trouble with other members of the family. But I was just wondering, do you have a favorite?
It's a girl and a boy relationship is different. I dote over my son. He's like he's my first love. Like, you know, like he's like the man of the house, even though he's four. Like I hang on every word. I don't know what it is. You know what I mean? He tells me what to do. And I just adore him because he's just, he's the boy. He's rough and tough and something. I had two sisters. I never had a boy. So it's like everything he does is new. You know what I mean? Everybody does the dancing school. You did it all, the whole thing. But he's a boy. So everything that he does that he's interested in, like the men, the Ninja Turtles, the guys, like the noises. but I become, you know, an Avenger. You know what I mean? I become the Hulk. I become it all. And it's like, it's new to me. It's new to me. You know, it's just, it's different. It's different. Yeah.
I get that. It's a completely different energy.
Yes.
And, you know, psychologists say that, you know, when you're a mom and you have a son, you are the son's first female love.
No, I cry my
eyes out. You become the example of what love is to them as far as women are, and vice versa for daughters with their fathers, you know?
Yes, yes.
I was in the audience at her performance. She'll tell you that she's her parents' favorite, and the audience will possibly agree with that one.
My parents have us all their favorite for different things, and they're very obvious what they are. You know what I mean?
Okay. So
we're all their favorites in different things. I'm always the one to lighten the mood, you know, not make it serious. Mm-hmm. My oldest thinks that, you know, she thought she was a woman at age 5. You know what I mean? She always had like all the files and everything. She's figuring out everything. You know what I mean? So everybody's their favorite in a different way. Listen, all your kids are your favorite. Every kid is a blessing. But there's different things with different kids. There is, you know, you can't mm-hmm. deny that.
Do you have like a beauty regimen that you do every day?
Beauty. All right.
I mean, you are beautiful. Your complexion is fantastic.
I brush my teeth. Mm-hmm. I wash my hair. Again, too.
It's shiny. You know, it's shiny.
Wash my hair. VO5. I shop at the dollar store.
Wait, you said VO5. Wait. OMG. Are you serious, Lisa Marie? VO5. That's like, how much does it cost? Like in 99 cents or something, right?
It's a dollar in the dollar store, but 88 cents, and they take coupons, and I use the coupons. Come on, stop. I'm not
wow. Do you
I'm use not the, all that money.
Do you remember the VO5 bomb that you would rub your hands together and put through your hair? Do you use that?
I don't use that.
I try to find it. I can't find it.
What is else? I use the shampoo. My life revolves around the Dollar Tree.
I would love to take a trip with you to the dollar store. And yes. I would love to you to teach me where to find the bargains that are like already bargained.
It's like a big deal. You know what I mean? But yeah, I stick to what I know. I'm not spending more than a dollar on my hair. Come on, what am I going to do with it? You know what I mean? $10 to go right down the drain. Come on, I've had it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to wash my hair for $10. It's going to go right down the sink. Come on. That's insulting.
That actually makes sense when you say it that way. Wow.
You spend all that money, just throw it to the curb. I feel terrible about it.
It just goes down the drain. That's it.
Yeah, I squeeze the quarter till the eagle screams. That's what I do. I live. That's my motto.
I would imagine that you get so many messages on social media, because this is my problem now. I get so many that I cannot keep up with it, no matter what I try to do. So do you have someone helping you? What do you do? Do you just say, I can't do it today, I'm not going to look at it? Like, I don't know. I was just wondering, maybe you have a different way of doing it that you can help me, because I'm just overwhelmed. And I would imagine you have like 50 times more emails than I do.
Well, no, I usually just make a general post about it. And I'd be like, hey guys, love yous. Thank you for checking in. And thanks for this, thanks for that. Because there's so many people you can't answer. I don't like to just answer it and then you can't talk to them. It's like rude. Because then you know, they want to have a conversation.
They do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I never want to be rude to somebody. So you just make it a general blanket statement. Or if you go live, you talk to everybody in the live, you address them. I rather it like that, because, you know,
your lives, the names must be going up like this. You can't possibly say it to everybody.
You have a good time in it and it's nice, but you could address people more, because in the messages, it's so impersonal. Like, you know, you just like, oh, thank you. And then you know what I mean? You don't want to be rude and not answer if something else comes up. You know what I mean? But a couple of messages that I see once in a while, like, oh, I would love if you could call my friend, and I'll call their friends or something like that.
And when you call their friends, do they believe it's you? Do you have to prove it?
It's unbelievable that somebody would want to talk to me. You know what I mean? Like, what am I doing? They would want to, and I think that that's so amazing. It's so wonderful. It really, really is. And I appreciate it. I do.
I think it's pretty obvious that you bring joy to people's lives, and you are like living proof that God has a sense of humor, right?
You gotta laugh.
You gotta laugh. So on that note, you know, I wanted to start this podcast because the intention of the podcast is to inspire, empower, and encourage people. So on that note, do you have any advice that you can give to people who are really struggling right now? Because obviously you were able to take something really tragic and horrific that was happening in your life, and you were able to push through it using humor. So is there something that you can give them that they can hold on to, that they can use in their own lives?
Something like my husband with sickness, cancer, unfortunately, and any sickness. While somebody's that sick, you want to cry all the time, and you want to cry, and you do, and you have your moments where you cry and everything else. But I've trained my brain, and I say to myself, well, cry when it's over. Hopefully it's never over, but I got the rest of my life to cry about it. So right now, while, you know what I mean? Where there's life, there's hope. And when you got things still going, there's people that have it worse, unfortunately. And you got to just enjoy each minute of every day, because tomorrow was promised to none of us, none of us. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? This could be our last Monday, our last Tuesday. You got to enjoy it, because you got the rest of your life to cry about the bad things. Live it. You got to live it, because if you let the misery of what's happening consume you, you're not going to live. And you're going to waste that time that you're here in misery. And it's easier said than done, but I try to train my brain, because there's so much to get out of life. The air that you breathe, the flowers that you see, the birds. It sounds crazy, but you train your brain. There's so much to appreciate.
Right.
You know,
right.
Get up and walk and talk and do things like this and meet people and have conversations. And everybody's got a struggle. They say if you throw your problems into the street, you pick the same ones back up. A lot of people wouldn't. But you get hit with hard balls, and sometimes things are never going to be better. Never. Mm-hmm. They're not going to be better. They're going to end terribly. But while they're still going on and all the chaos is happening, you got to find something that can get you through it. You gotta, because there's nothing else. This is life. Unfortunately, life gives you what it gives you. And you know, you can't handle it, but you got to look to others sometimes. You gotta.
At some point, we all have to suffer something, you know? I want to talk about crying for a second. Do you ever have what Oprah calls the ugly cry?
Often.
And alone. When you have the ugly cry, and I'm just curious, because I was thinking about this the other day. I recently had an ugly cry moment, and I noticed that I went to the mirror. Do you ever look at yourself to see how bad you look when you're
the ugly cry makes you cry more, and then you repeat the same phrase over and over? You ever do that? You repeat the same phrase over and over.
What phrase do you say to yourself?
What am I gonna do? When I stare at myself and I'm going, wait. Then I notice the wrinkles coming out. Then I get all and I hate myself. And then you stop crying suddenly. You go, what am I doing? Oh my God, when did I get that? Look at my chin. And then I realize that I have to on the neck, and the whole thing just becomes a mess. And then you're like, I have
cry
to
more.
You cry more. And I should have started my diet. And you got to laugh about it. You got to get it out sometimes. You got to get it out. Mm-hmm. You got to get it out. And sometimes you know the end result, nothing's going to get better. But unfortunately, it's a part of life.
Do you have angry moments or angry days when, you know, life is being unfair, you know?
Husband's cancer is pediatric. He hasn't had it since a child, but it's pediatric. And it's on the floor with all the children. You walk to that floor, you see those kids, and you say to yourself, what's going on here? Why does this happen? Mm-hmm. Does it make sense? Make any sense? And I look at those parents and I say, or guardians or whoever it may be, I go, how the hell are they doing this? So I got it bad. I got to watch, you know, him through that. My son, watch him go through that. Family, watch him go through that. But then I think of those people and I say to myself, we're all in this together, but we all have a different struggle. And, you know, things aren't fair. Things aren't fair in life, but I, you know, part of life. And there's no answers for it. There's no answers. But what could you do? You know, we're all saying the same prayers and we're all praying for the same thing, and you got to wait in line for your miracle. And sometimes you just don't get it. It's a long line of miracles.
If you had a chance to sit down with God for 2 minutes, what would you ask?
Why do you make things happen the way that they do? What's the reasoning behind it? And I would say to him, why did you give everybody a timeline? What made you do that?
why do some of us have shorter ones and some of us have longer ones?
And I know people say, oh, because it's your time, but I want to know why. Why? You know what I mean? I would like to just know why. I don't have the answer, but I'd like to know why. Why do you choose somebody leaves earlier than others or never makes it here? Why? Like, what's the reasoning behind that? I would be curious to know. I would be. I think about that. I would love to know why.
Now, if you ever got to visit heaven, what would you do while you're there?
Oh, I want to, I ever got to visit, of course, see all my family and friends, unfortunately, that are there and I'm not here anymore. And I would just want to, I would just want everybody there together. You know what I mean? If we all got to go, let's all go together. And maybe we'll be together. That's what I hope. You know what I mean? I don't like to think of the end because I'm having such a wonderful time here. Yeah, I am. Yeah. I mean,
it's not so bad being here, right? I mean, it has its problems, but there are some really beautiful and joyous moments, especially.
There's a lot of bad. It is bad here a lot of the times and everything going on, but I got a lot of good out of this thing. I got a lot of good out of life. I got a beautiful, healthy son that I'm more grateful for than anything. I waited a long time for him. I'm lucky enough to have a beautiful family. I'm lucky enough to be here. I got a roof over my head. I got food in my refrigerator. I'm pretty lucky.
You got a clip in your hair.
A hair clip in my hair that I took from Who Cut Your Hair on Avenue U when I first got my seventh grade. Left it. I never left it. I didn't care about it.
Lisa Marie, let me ask you, do you have a celebrity crush?
Celebrity crush. Well, this is the biggest joke. Tom Hardy. We used to joke around about Tom Hardy because I used to laugh at him because he played that movie when he was the two guys. And I was like, wow, are they twins? Try to figure out forever if they were twins instead of just looking on American Online to see if they were twins or if it was one guy. This went off. Yeah, but Tom Hardy was the one that's like, oh my God. Ben Affleck, only in the town.
But Affleck?
No offense, Ben, but I only had the crush on him in the movie, The Town. And then after that, we broke up.
Oh, okay. So yeah. So what was it about his character or the way he seemed in that movie?
I just feel like, I don't know. I just feel like I was ready to walk by the lake. You know, when he walks by the lake with her, when she's blindfolded, I just felt like I was there.
So let's say he was here today. Ben Affleck was here and he put a blindfold around you and he walked by the lake with you. What do you think he would say to you?
If you were single, yes.
Let's respect the fact that you are a married woman. We're just having fun.
No, believe it or not. No, because I'm serious. So I even tell my husband, believe it or not, there's nobody I'd want to like leave him for. Like, what are we going to do? Like, what am I going to do? Like, I want to be home. I don't want to go do that, get dressed up, going out. Like, I'm not in the mood for that. I'm really not. I swear to God, I'd be annoyed. I don't want to go get all dressed up. I don't like to fly. I would be no help to anybody. I'm scared to fly. So how would I be able to live this? It would never work. It would never, ever work because I'm not going to buy clothes and I can't find anything that fits right. You know what I mean? Like, what am I going to do with that? What can I possibly do? There's nothing we would have fun doing. It just would be over. It'd be over before it starts.
You said you're afraid of flying. What is it about flying that makes you afraid?
The last time I flew, the pilot, yes, my sister, the pilot came out. He said, I suggest you never fly again. I was ascending in the air.
No.
I was in the air. I rose.
No way.
I'm very loud about it. I told everybody, I don't know what's happening. They weren't even asking me. The man next to me, I had his sweater scrunched into my hands. I said to him, are you okay? He goes, I don't think you it was so wild.
So you hit a bad air pocket. Is that what you're saying? You had bad turbulence?
I just like being on land. I like being on land. I don't have to go nowhere. I'll see pictures. Let me know how it was.
Flying is the ultimate form of trust.
I don't trust no one. I don't trust nothing. I don't want to do nothing. I want to walk to the corner store and come home and I'm good. I don't feel like I'm missing out. What am I going to see? A toucan? I'll just look at TV. I don't even swim. I don't even wear a bathing suit. So why do
I can't swim either. The water, and I have grand respect for the water.
I'm not going to go somewhere hot because what am I going to do there? Sweat? I'll just sweat home. I'll put the air conditioner.
So it's safe to say you enjoy being home.
It's safe. I like being home. I don't gotta go nowhere. I don't gotta lose weight before the trip. Like, you know what I mean?
So what's the furthest you would go with a gig? If like, you know.
I drove to Florida. I drove there. I was not flying. What a disaster that was, driving with the baby in the car. It was just like a whole other experience, but I was petrified to fly. I'll take it in a car. They got the cars that drive. I'll drive everywhere I got to go. Where am I going to go? Nobody wants to see me somewhere far, far away. Where are they going to go? I'll drive.
I don't think that's true. I think lots of people would see you far away. I think you're great. I think you're hilarious. I had such a good time, you know, watching your videos and, you know, reading up about you and things like that. You know, I think the thing that people really connect with you with is that you're real and you're really honest, brutally honest, but in a funny way. And not everybody has that talent. That is a talent.
I'm a broken Brita. I never cared. If somebody doesn't like me, I don't care. I'm never rude. But this is it. You take me. Take me as I am, or don't take me at all. You know what I mean? There's a cover for every pot.
I like that.
It's like my grandmother. There's a cover for every pot, she would say. It's so true. And not everybody's for everybody, and that's okay. But I feel no need to sort of like to lie to people or to make it up like who I am. This is who I am. This is it.
How do you handle the haters, if you have any?
You never know what they're going through. Maybe they needed somebody to take their anger out on. Take it out on me. I don't care. I'd rather it be to me, because there's some people that get really hurt by it. I don't get really hurt by it. I mean, come on. I grew up with two sisters. Nobody could say nothing. I couldn't hate myself more than living with them. They made you hate yourself. You never wanted to know. And nothing shocks me. When people go like, oh, you're so fat. Like, I don't need you to tell me that. I know what we're doing.
I don't think you're fat at all.
Thank you so much. But you see the top portion of me. And I don't hide the bottom for any other reason. Mm-hmm. I don't have a phone holder that's going to get my whole body. So this is holding up. I got the powder holding you up. But I don't care if they think you're not for everybody. Not everybody's going to like you. That's okay. That's what makes the world go round. Mm-hmm. But I don't get offended. I just wish them well, because maybe they're going through something. Maybe that's how they were spoken to. So that's the only way they know how to communicate. But I'm glad they feel comfortable enough to tell me, because they get it off their chest. You die once, you say what you got to say. Listen, we go from there. All right. What are you going to do? What do you want to do? What do you want to tango? Like, what do you want
to do? I think that the listeners and the viewers are probably asking, okay, but Lisa Marie, how do you get to that point where you don't care? What is it that you say to yourself that you honestly get to that part that you feel like you believe it? I don't care what you think about me, because most people do care. So how did you get to that point? Was it always in you, or?
It was always in me. I never cared. You know why? Because, you know, I don't mind and you don't matter. It happens. Not everybody's going to like you, and I'm okay with that. And then you're not for me. We'll move it along. There's bigger problems. There's bigger to worry about somebody not liking you, or the way you look, or the way you talk, or the way you act. People go, you disgrace the English language. All right, then I disgrace the English language. All right. Okay, what are you looking? What was your intention with that statement? Where was this gonna go? So you're not gonna hang so I guess you're not gonna hang out with me. So you're telling me I'm not getting the birthday card. Like, what do you want me to do?
you're not gonna work for Hallmark anytime soon.
Yes, that's
actually,
it.
You should do that, Lisa Marie. You should do your own line of Hallmark cards.
Good for me.
What would you call it?
Oh wow, this is fancy.
Vinny, don't you think she would do a great job with that?
She would be amazing, like sentiments, like Lisa-isms in a card. Yes. Like, you know, happy birthday, good for us.
Every cover for a pot.
You know, happy birthday, I'm done, you know?
Good for you, have fun.
Right, right. Like, that's what you should definitely do, Lisa-isms. Absolutely.
That sounds wonderful. That sounds wonderful. What am I going to do with myself?
Like, I want you to patent it when we hang up tonight.
Yes. Yes. Do that before someone beats you to it.
They're probably going to. They're quicker than me. They know what they're doing. I mean, I'm not going to, you know what I mean? What are we going to do? I have no idea how to work American Online. I have no idea how to work any of that. What are we going to do? Listen, you can spend your life worrying about the people that are saying bad things and not acknowledge the people that say the good. And then you're missing it.
Amen to that. Amen to that. Amen to that. I like that a lot.
You know, it's all perspective, because like people would sit and really think about the stuff that they hear from people. And then somebody like you letting it roll off. That's true. There's such a perspective.
Even famous people. What about all the other thousands of people that are saying wonderful things? Why not address them?
Mm-hmm.
The truth.
That's really good. I'm going to keep that in the back of my mind the next time I have that.
And you just realize it is what it is. Everybody's got enough. Everybody was made different and everybody sees things different. You know, the way I see the color red and the way you see the color red, we're never going to know if it's the same. We're all different. And that's okay. Let's see what they got to say. They felt comfortable enough to vent to you. Okay. Maybe they got something going on. It made them feel better. You served your purpose. You were there to let them feel better. God bless. Bravo. Moving along.
Amen to that. Yeah. All right. So sure. let me ask you this question. If you could come back as any kind of animal, what animal would you be?
Honestly, I don't know if I'd be active, so I can't be a bird because I don't want to fly for my food. I just want to sit there. Maybe, honestly, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. I mean, if I was a house pet, I'd rather be a house pet.
Would you be a cat or would you be a dog?
I would probably be a cat because I just want to relax. I feel like cats relax. You know what I mean? I feel like they relax and they get, you know, they don't have to do anything. A dog, they expect you to play with the ball and be active. I don't want to do that.
But then you got to deal with the fur balls.
That's the only problem I'll have. Let it be the biggest one. I don't want to go on a walk. I don't want to go to the dog park and like running around with everybody. I be alone. You know what I mean? Sitting under the bed on the couch. I'll just be the cat. Done.
All right. I'm just going to throw some things out here. Just tell me when I say it, let's tell me what automatically comes to your mind. Okay. You open your refrigerator. What's the one thing you want to go to feel better? What's your stress food?
The bread. I am a body built on carbs. Anything bread comes right and it processes through my, it doesn't leave. It just goes to an area. It goes to an undisclosed location and it sticks.
What do you think about thongs?
I don't even know what the purpose of those are. I haven't an idea why you have to have a string up your rear ends. I don't know. I get it.
How do you feel about bras?
When I do decide to partake in that, when I can locate mine, wonderful. I mean, it serves its purpose. Yeah.
Bathing suit shopping.
My stomach doesn't even know what the sun looks like. It would be great.
Oh no, my God. Yeah. Do you have any words for, and I'm not saying that you're going through this, but do you have any words for women who are perimenopausal / menopausal, anything you can give to them for hope for, to help them just get through it?
I'm not going through that yet, but I was with my mother when she was going through it. And I regret every day that I spent with her while she was going through it, because it was a nightmare. It was a nightmare. It was scary. I was afraid because... just be on the fan, off the fan, on the fan, off the fan, on the fan, off the fan. That's another question. If I had a third question, I'd ask God, why? What is happening here? Why do we have to do? What purpose does that serve?
Yes, think of it.
What is the purpose? And what are we trying to do here? See how much we can do. I don't want to be a strong woman. I want to know. I don't want this. I want to skip that part. I want to skip the whole part of it. Yeah.
So many people turn to you for their relief. Who does Lisa Marie turn to for relief?
I find humor in everything. I can make myself laugh in a dark room. You know, I just find humor in everything. I mean, I have conversations with myself sometimes and I just laugh because I try to just like take my mind off of where it is. And yeah, I like anything to laugh. I like to just, you know, as a matter of fact, I'm going to this dance. I guess it's a dance. It's not called a dance, but I'm old, so I say dance. And they invited me to go. This woman invited me to go. I said, okay, I'm going. I'm going with the other class mom in school. She's my polar opposite. She is my polar opposite. Like, she's got the agenda and everything down. Me, I'm a total opposite. I go, come on now with her. They asked me. I didn't even know I was the class mom, but I am. And you know, and we were talking about you too, Judy. I said, could you imagine if Judy would come? That would be wonderful and perform. It would be a nice night. So what was I getting to? I totally lost myself on track. I got all caught up.
That happens to me all the time. Literally all the time.
Vin, would you
It was just about basically the fact that you can find humor in anything.
I find humor. We're going to this event. We're going to this dance, and we're just looking forward to it. And I said, we're going to have a good time. We never get out. And with everything going on between, you know, sickness and COVID, I said, we're looking forward to it. And hopefully I can, you know, it'll be a fun night. And hopefully we get to go and just have a good time, because I haven't been out in 766 years. And I I made a very broad statement. I told her to tell her husband too. I said, listen, whatever happens that night, you know, we're going to have a good time. I want to come home. I want to lose one shoe. You know, when you lose the one shoe, that means how much fun you had.
Well, I don't know if I've ever lost a shoe. That must be fun.
And you guys share a little bit of the common thread here. Lisa's got a show coming up at the Palladium, Judy.
You do.
Oh, you do too?
I do too. When is your show?
April 23rd.
Nice. Oh, I don't know. I have so many shows. I have a lot of shows. I'm a little bit lost. I'm not going to lie.
I'm going to have to come to one of yours, and I want to talk to you afterwards about what it would take to get you to the dance.
When is the date for the dance?
April 22nd.
Hold on. I may be able to help you.
Go for us.
We may be able to make that happen, girl.
Judy, date night at the dance, Judy. We'll go crash the dance.
That's what we're going to do.
Why not? Good for us. Let's do it.
Awesome. Yeah. Lisa Marie, thank you so much. Guys, thank you for tuning in. You can check out One Funny Lisa Marie. She's on Facebook, Instagram, TikTok. Are you on Twitter too?
Please, with that.
One Funny Lisa Marie, just Google her. Trust me, you'll find her. She's everywhere. She will make you laugh, and she's highly entertaining. I want to thank you for coming. And I just, you know, I keep hearing this one line in my head. I was in the off-Broadway show, My Big Gay Italian Wedding, years ago. Yes. And I had this one line that every time I look at you, I want to say it. The higher the hair, the closer to God. And that clip is everything. So you are closer to God. You make us laugh. And I thank you so much for sharing your gift with us. God bless you and your family. We love you. We thank you for being on.
Thank you so much for having me. Go for us. I loved it. I had a wonderful time. You better keep in touch with me. Go for us.
Lisa Marie Riley.
I love her. I love how real she is. I love, she's spontaneously funny. And it's kind of like this kind of, I don't care thing. I don't care. You know, I love it. It's wonderful. And it was really good, because last week I was crying the first and second episode, I was crying. So it was nice to laugh. And the thing I love about her is like, I don't know when the punchline is coming. It just comes, and it's beautiful, because it's very, very, it comes with ease. You know, it's effortless for her.
And I think that she's not surprised by anything. Like, she does a live question and answer after her like set does is she? Done. Uh-huh. And I was sitting with her father in the audience at the theater she played, and she took any question. And a guy asked if she was wearing a bra, because she went on this whole thing about bras. Oh, so the guy says, so tell us, Lisa, then are you wearing a bra? And she handled it with such grace. And the father was so mortified, like, is he nuts asking my daughter if she's wearing a bra? And she just took it. She took it. She handled it. 30 good seconds. She ripped the guy in a good way. And then she just kept moving on with business. Do you think that certain people are just built like that? Or do you think that it takes time for these kinds of skills and mechanisms within us to build up?
I think it's both. But I think for her, it seems like it's always been there. Especially because I asked her, she was, oh, please, you know, I don't care what anybody thinks, you know. So that's a hard place to get to, because I have a lot of clients that I coach that's their big thing. You know, I want to get to the point where I don't care what people think or say about me anymore. And it's hard. It's really hard. It's like on social media, you know, I can get 499 great things said, and one person says something dumb, and I'm like tragically affected by that, you know. I've grown thicker skin since. It doesn't really get to me as much anymore, but I still can't say I don't care. You know, I still care a little bit. So I would love to get to that place. So listening to her and why she thinks that way was really helpful to me. And I hope it helped a lot of people today.
Absolutely. Do you think it would have helped Mimi Martinez?
No, nothing would have helped. Nothing would have helped Mimi Martinez. If you guys, if you're just tuning in, I was on episode 14 of season 12 called Allegiance. I played Mimi Martinez. I was in the beginning of the show, and it's like what the fans were like. They were like, "Yay, Judy! What happened? What the heck? You know, because I died so fast."
But it set the tone for the whole episode.
Oh, it was great.
And so here's my takeaways. Okay. Cause you know, I watched with bated breath. I have been a big Judy Torres fan since before I met her at 11 years old. So I was always a super Judy fan. So my big takeaway, Donnie Wahlberg's a freestyle freak, because there was a shot of you from behind and he said, and it looks like you're going into the Puerto Rican Wonder Woman. And I could just see that. It absolutely is what it looked like. Okay. I have the receipts to prove it. And, you know, it's like I could see Judy Torres opening for New Kids on the Block on the new tour. I really think so. And I know Donnie checks you out on Instagram because I seen that he's liked your post.
He did like my post. And that was so cool. And let me just say that he was, and everybody was, so amazing, so professional, intensely professional. It is a very well-run machine over there. And they were just incredibly welcoming, incredibly helpful. Shout out to Joey Cola, who played the MC.
Great guy.
He's a live MC in real life. He warms up he warms up the crowds for all the talk shows, including the Drew Barrymore show. And that's not the set. We actually shot on her set. So it was awesome when I was in the wings, you know, waiting for me to come out when we did the scene. And I kept thinking, this would be really cool to have a talk show. Like I could feel that. I could literally, like I literally went out and I thought to myself, I could do this. So it was fun. And the role came really naturally to me. I was excited as soon as I heard hola. I saw on the script, it said, she says hola everyone. I thought, I say hola mi gente, it's the same thing. I could do that, you know?
But I think there was some similarities. What did they say? She's a motivational positive speaker or something.
They said she was the queen of—
the queen of daytime. You're the queen of freestyle. You were a best-selling really nice author. Like it was all—
it was really nice. It's stuff that I will be.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Speak it into the universe now.
And the next takeaway we had was that I grew up in a house raised by a street gangster mother. And we're sitting there watching it, and my mother knew that. She said, Oh no, there's something more to this. She goes, I know they're questioning this guy. She goes, I know they're questioning this guy, but, you know, I think somebody on her staff actually offed her. Offed. My mother used the term offed her. Offed. Yeah. So, and by the episode's reveal, we see what happens. If you haven't seen it yet, you should check it out. And yeah, it was interesting. It was great. I think for me, what was so exciting was like network television, a major show. Oh my God, that's my friend. Look at her go.
That was just, I can't even tell you, you know, I remember when we were getting ready to do the first take, typically when I do something that I'm not used to, when it's something, it's the first time I do something, I'm usually really, really scared. I'm usually really scared almost to the point of tears. Even when I did the one woman show, when I did my big gay Italian wedding, the first time I performed No Reason to Cry, I remember just, you know, standing on the side going, oh my God, why am I doing this? Oh my God, why? And it's like this feeling of dread. And then I go out there and I'm like, you know, and I somehow pushed through it, but I've always been that scared. But that day I was thinking, Mr. Roman, my high school music teacher, would be so excited for me right now. And I thought to myself, I spent a lot of my life being afraid, you know, and I just thought this time, you know what, I'm not going to be scared. Because number one, the casting agency casted me. The producer, the director, they approved me, right? So that you got cast. So that means they already like you. That means they like the way you did the audition. And all you have to do is do the same thing when you get on set. But you have to, you know, you have to know your lines. And believe me, for 2 weeks straight, I was rehearsing those lines. And then 2 days before, I was in the bathtub. I had this ritual. I drew a bath. I lay down in the bath. I lit a little candle. And all I did was say my lines over and over and over again for like 2 hours straight. I never stopped. I tried to say them slowly, quickly, like really racing, just to make sure that it would just fall off my lips so that it would be as natural as possible by the time I got there. And thank God I did. But I thought to myself, I don't want to be scared anymore. I want to enjoy it. I want to have fun, you know? And that's what I did. I had fun. And maybe that's why it seemed like okay, because it was fun. It was a lot of fun. And I thought, like, no lie, I could get used to this. I could get used to this. It's a great, I just love the creative process. I love working with people. It was great to see how TV actually works. You know, that 1 minute that I was on, I think we did like 10 or 12 takes. Not because we messed up or anything, but more because they want to get different points of views and using different cameras. You know, sometimes they weren't Donnie Wahlberg, sometimes they weren't me, you know, all these different things. And it was great. And I want to shout out the extras too, because when we see extras on the screen, we don't think of anything that they're doing. But the truth is, when I was talking, a lot of them were smiling back at me. So I was able to pick certain people in the audience to talk to, and that helped me a lot. And having all the experience performing in freestyle, because when I'm on stage, I will find different people to look at, that helped me to do that role. So it was just a great experience. And if you guys haven't seen it, check it out on demand. I think it's on Paramount Plus as well. It's season 12, episode 14. Not that I'm trying to plug it again, but it was just a great, I swear to God, it was a great experience. I could cross that off my list of things to do before I die, but I don't want it to be the last time.
I think there's going to be a lot more coming your way. I just feel it. Absolutely. And hopefully we could bring Mimi back from the dead and she becomes, you know.
You know, one of the fans said on Facebook that she wants a spinoff show about how Mimi Martinez became Mimi Martinez. I love that idea.
I think,
so CBS, if you're listening, let's do it.
I'm wondering if when Poochie finally returns to Beautiful Life, she can resurrect Mimi.
Yeah, Poochie needs to make a comeback. She's been quiet lately.
Yeah, I'd like to see Poochie and Mimi have a conversation together.
I would like that too.
So Judy, any final thoughts regarding today's topic? I think it's great. We've seen the definition of resilience, yes, of perseverance, of
we
pushing.
Want to shout out One Funny Lisa Marie. We want to thank her for coming on. I think she taught us a lot. I think she taught us that even in tragedy, you can find humor. She taught us what it means to just keep plugging forward. She taught us about being grateful for the little things, because that's what happens when you're going through a lot. And that, listen, everywhere we go, someone has it worse than us. So we just have to appreciate the life we've been given and just keep on going, and everything's going to be okay eventually. And on that note, just remember, there's no reason to cry.
If you have a topic or something that you would like to speak about on an edition of Beautiful Life with Judy Torres, send her an email, judytorreslifecoach@gmail.com or www.judytorreslifecoach.com. Be sure to subscribe on YouTube, follow this podcast everywhere that it is on major platforms, so we can help you find the beautiful life that you deserve.
Okay, I love you. Bye-bye.